Reading from Srimad-Bhagavatam, Canto 1, Chapter 13. Chapter 13 is entitled, Dhritarashtra Quits Home. Text number 8. Yudhishthira Vacha Apismarathano Yushmat Pakshachaya Samedhitan Vipadganad Vishagnyader Mochitayatsa Matrikaha. Translation and purport by His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada. Translation. Maharaj Yudhishthira said, My uncle, do you remember how you always protected us, along with our mother, from all sorts of calamities? Your partiality, like the wings of a bird, saved us from poisoning and arson. Purport by Srila Prabhupada. Due to Pandu's death at an early age, his minor children and widow were the object of special care by all elderly members of the family, especially Bhishma Deva and Mahatma Vidura. Vidura was more or less partial to the Pandavas due to their political position. Although Dhritarashtra was equally careful for the minor children of Maharaj Pandu, he was one of the intriguing parties who wanted to wash away the descendants of Pandu and replace them by raising his own sons to become the rulers of the kingdom. Mahatma Vidura could follow this intrigue of Dhritarashtra and company, and therefore, even though he was a faithful servitor of his eldest brother Dhritarashtra, he did not like his political ambition for the sake of his own sons. He was therefore very careful about the protection of the Pandavas and their widow mother. Thus he was, so to speak, partial to the Pandavas, preferring them to the sons of Dhritarashtra, although both of them were equally affectionate in his ordinary eyes. He was equally affectionate to both the camps of the nephews, in the sense that he always chastised Duryodhana for his intriguing policy against his cousins. He always criticized his elder brother for his policy of encouragement to his sons. And at the same time, he was always alert in giving special protection to the Pandavas. All these different activities of Vidura within the palace politics made him well known as partial to the Pandavas. Maharaj Yudhishthira has referred to the past history of Vidura before his going away from home for a prolonged pilgrim's journey. Maharaj Yudhishthira reminded him that he was equally kind and partial to his grown-up nephews even after the Battle of Kurukshetra, a great family disaster. Before the Battle of Kurukshetra, Dhritarashtra's policy was peaceful annihilation of his nephews, and therefore he ordered Purochana to build a house at Varanavata. And when the building was finished, Dhritarashtra desired that his brother's family live there for some time. When the Pandavas were going there in the presence of all the members of the royal family, Vidura tactfully gave instructions to the Pandavas about the future plan of Dhritarashtra. This is specifically described in the Mahabharata, Adi Parva 1.1.4. He indirectly hinted, a weapon not made of steel or any other material element can be more than sharp to kill an enemy, and he who knows this is never killed. That is to say, he hinted that the party of the Pandavas was being sent to Varanavata to be killed, and thus he warned Yudhishthira to be very careful in their new residential palace. He also gave indications of fire and said that fire cannot extinguish the soul but can annihilate the material body. But one who protects the soul can live. Kunti could not follow such indirect conversations between Maharaj Yudhishthira and Vidura. And thus, when she inquired from her son about the purport of the conversation, Yudhishthira replied that from the talks of Vidura, it was understood that there was a hint of fire in the house where they were proceeding. Later on, Vidura came in disguise to the Pandavas and informed them that the housekeeper was going to set fire to the house on the 14th night of the waning moon. It was an intrigue of Dhritarashtra that the Pandavas might die altogether with their mother. And by his warning, the Pandavas escaped through a tunnel underneath the earth, so that their escape was also unknown to Dhritarashtra. So much so that after setting the fire, the Kauravas were so certain of the death to the Pandavas that Dhritarashtra performed the last rites of death with great cheerfulness. And during the mourning period, all the members of the palace became overwhelmed with lamentation. But Vidura did not become so because of his knowledge that the Pandavas were alive somewhere. There are many such instances of calamities, and in each of them, Vidura gave protection to the Pandavas on one hand, and on the other, he tried to restrain his brother Dhritarashtra from such intriguing policies. Therefore, he was always partial to the Pandavas, just as a bird protects its eggs by its wings. Thus ends the Bhaktivedanta purport. So this chapter, Dhritarashtra quits home, very nicely describes Vidura returning after a long pilgrimage to Hastinapura, the palace of Yudhishthira Maharaj. This was after the battle of Kurukshetra. And Vidura has come to deliver his brother Dhritarashtra. This is the compassion a devotee shows to somebody who is in ignorance, somebody who is entangled, somebody who is completely oblivious of the ultimate spiritual goal of life. Vidura was a true well-wisher of Dhritarashtra. Even though Vidura used to give advice to Dhritarashtra, which seemed like Vidura was partial to the Pandavas, but still he was a true well-wisher of Dhritarashtra. And that is very evident in this chapter, that finally Dhritarashtra was delivered because of the specific instructions given by Vidura to Dhritarashtra, how Dhritarashtra should actually prepare for the end of his life. So now the description is being given that Vidura has come to the palace after traveling on pilgrimage. So in the third canto, it will be described during pilgrimage where all he visited, and most importantly, Vidura made inquiries from Maitreya Rishi in Badrikashrama. He went to all the holy places of pilgrimage, and he was searching for hearing Krishna Katha, topics about Krishna, from the Krishna realized soul. So Vidura is setting an example for all of us that everyone should be actually very much keen on hearing Krishna Katha from somebody who has realized Krishna. This way, it is very easy to become Krishna conscious and to prepare for quitting the body in Krishna consciousness to achieve the highest perfection of going back to Krishna at the end of this life. So Vidura has come after the pilgrimage, and it is described in the previous few verses of this chapter that Vidura stopped inquiring when he became established in transcendental loving service to Lord Krishna by becoming enlightened by hearing from Maitreya Rishi about Krishna. Then Vidura considered the fact that Dhritarashtra was still alive, even though all his sons died in the battle of Kurukshetra. So he was very much grief-stricken that he lost all his sons. All his plans for enthroning his own sons while he was the caretaker king were completely spoiled. He tried in so many ways to silently kill the Pandavas when the Pandavas were young. So this history is being remembered by Yudhishthira when Yudhishthira welcomed Vidura to the palace. So Yudhishthira is mentioning to Vidura, "My uncle, do you remember how you always protected us along with our mother from all sorts of calamities? The Pandavas had to face so many calamities. This is called palace politics. This existed even in the previous yugas. It is human nature. Especially conditioned souls in this material world who are desirous of enjoying materially, who desire to lord over this material world, they always are looking for different ways and means to get money, to get power, to get some position, to become influencers of others, simply to control others for the sake of exploiting others for their own sense gratification. This is a whole program of conditioned souls in this material world. So much so that such a mentality prevails even among pious souls who are residing in the upper planets. Even Indra, who is very, very pious, Indra is famous as Shatakratu. He is famous for having performed 100 Ashwamedha Yajnas. To perform one Ashwamedha Yajna is so difficult. So many arrangements have to be made, elaborate arrangements. Ashwamedha Yajna involves a horse to be sacrificed in a proper sacrificial fire. Now the specifications for such a sacrifice to be performed given in the scriptures are very stringent. The king who wants to perform this Ashwamedha Yajna has to first of all find a qualified, suitable Brahmana priest. Not one priest, there are going to be a whole team of priests. And they should be qualified, they should be willing to guide the king to perform this yajna. Then the king has to search for a suitable horse. It can't be any horse that is simply offered in sacrifice. It has to be a suitable horse. So finding the sacrificial horse with all those conditions is itself very, very, very difficult. And then arrangement for the sacrifice itself. Elaborate arrangements have to be made. So after finding the qualified Brahmana priests, Brahmanas don't easily agree to perform a sacrifice, because in such a sacrifice they should be able to chant the mantras in such a way that the animal being sacrificed is promoted to a higher birth. Generally, the animal is directly promoted to get a human birth. In very rare cases, the animal is completely delivered from material existence. So that should be the power of chanting the mantra by the Brahmanas. In the least benefit that animal being sacrificed should get is that it should get a human birth. So, to be able to chant the mantras in such a way that the animal, the soul in the animal's body which is being sacrificed, is purified of all past reactions, so that there is no impediment for that soul to get immediately a human birth without having to perform a wait for such a human birth. Generally, when a soul degrades into an animal body or a lower life form, it is because of so many grievous sinful activities. So until all those sinful reactions are suffered by the soul in different types of species, different types of bodies, until one gets the human form, gradually progressing from lower life forms to higher life forms. This is a complete science of the movement of the living entity through different species. This is described in the third canto in some detail by Lord Kapila in his instructions to Mother Devahuti. So, a priest who is able to chant the mantras to in that sacrifice where the animal is being sacrificed, that soul in the animal's body gets a human form immediately on actually being killed, and the animal itself, the animal's body being offered in sacrifice, in sacrificial fire, the soul is directly promoted to the human form in the least benefit that the soul can get. Can even get promoted to a higher form than a human being. And the best is that the soul goes back to Godhead. So, such a Brahmana priest to find is not easy, even in the former times. Not all Brahmanas were so qualified. There were Brahmanas with different qualifications at different levels. So, to find a qualified Brahmana, and then the Brahmana should be willing to take some karma that is involved in such a sacrificial performance. Because the performer of the sacrifice, the yajaman, like the king, he has to actually purify himself of his reactions in such a sacrificial ceremony. So, where will the reactions go? Some of the reactions will be accepted by the priest. who is willing to take such reactions because of his tapas shakti, his power of austerity, he is able to completely nullify such reactions which accrue from the yajaman getting purified. See, the laws of nature are very, very, very stringent. Whatever action anybody performs, especially in the human form of life, every action is to be accounted. There is a specific reaction for every action. Only activities done in devotional service, there is no reaction whatsoever. On the other hand, devotional service guarantees that our reactions from the past will be burnt away to ashes. Karmani nirdahati kintu cha bhakti bhajam. In the Brahma Samhita it is said, one who performs devotional service, practices bhakti yoga, the reactions to the activities performed in the past before accepting the path of devotional service, whatever reactions were there, are burnt away to ashes. It's only possible through devotional service. To a small extent, some of the reactions can be nullified by performing different types of tapasya. If a king himself performs tapasya, anybody performs tapasya personally, then they can nullify some of the reactions without having to undergo suffering due to those reactions in future lives. But when somebody performs bhakti yoga, then very quickly all the reactions can be completely nullified. So in the scriptures there is clear description of two paths of elevation to achieve ultimate perfection or ultimate goal of life. There is the gradual path of elevation to the highest level of perfection, and there is the direct, quick path. So the gradual path is the non-devotional path. In the non-devotional path, first of all, one, a person, a soul who has got human form of life, learns to discriminate between sinful activities and pious activities. Discriminating between sinful activities and pious activities, one abstains from sinful activities, understanding that sinful activities are the cause of all suffering. Then one performs only pious activities. But still, every conditioned soul has got some desire for material enjoyment. So, in the gradual path of advancement, one abstains from sinful activities but performs pious activities for getting some material gain or material pleasure or material benefit. But as one goes on performing pious activities for some material benefit or material gain or material happiness, one realizes that material happiness or material gain ultimately is not satisfying the soul, the real self. So then when one makes inquiries, how can I get inner satisfaction? How can I get lasting happiness? Then one becomes inquisitive to understand the real truth about the self, beyond simply performing some pious activities to avoid some suffering and enjoy some material gain or material benefits. That is when one is promoted from the platform of karma to the platform of jnana. The platform of karma is to discriminate between sinful activities and pious activities, avoid sinful activities, and only perform pious activities. The Vedas have got this section called Karma Kanda section, which describes in great detail for any type of material desire a human being can have, what is the particular pious activity one should perform to get that material benefit, specific material benefit, with the aim of people being restrained from sinful activities in order to enjoy life. That is the aim of Karma Kanda section of the Vedas, to encourage people to avoid sinful activities. So this is the civilized way of human form of life, that civilized people generally have got the inclination to follow rules and regulations, avoid sinful activities, and thereby avoid lot of different types of punishment or suffering due to the stringent laws of nature, and perform only pious activities. And even if they are interested in some specific material benefit, they want to get that benefit only through performing pious activities, however long it may take, however difficult it may be. So they are inclined to perform all kinds of sacrifice, yajna, dana, tapa, give all kinds of charity, or perform different kinds of vrata, austerities. But the aim is how to get material enjoyment, material pleasure, material benefits, material position, a materially beneficial position. But in course of time, a intelligent person, a thoughtful person, a conscientious person realizes that any amount of such pious activities is not going to give me the real happiness, inner satisfaction. And that gives rise to the quest for knowledge. Knowledge beyond ordinary understanding of pious and sinful actions, etc. So this is the impetus for people to inquire into the nature of the self, into spiritual inquiry. This is where spiritual inquiry begins, when one comes to the platform of jnana. But jnana also, merely trying to find out what is the truth about this world. Who am I? Why am I not getting my real satisfaction or happiness even after performing only pious activities? What more is required to be done to get real happiness? So this inquiry is called Brahma Jignyasa or Tattva Jignyasa. The Bhagavatam begins with that. Bhagavatam says that Jivasya Tattva Jignyasa. The only business of a human being is to inquire into the absolute truth. In the Vedanta philosophy also, presented by Vyasadeva, he says, Athato Brahma Jignyasa. Now that you've got a human form of life, simply be concerned about what is the absolute truth. That's the only business of a human being, nothing else. Nartho yascheha karma bihi. Whatever actions one performs, the aim should be to realize the absolute truth, and nothing else should be the aim of life. So in the Bhagavatam, even in the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says, Vedaischa sarvair ahameva vedyam. In the third chapter, he says the importance of following Vedic directions. And in the 15th chapter, he says, the goal of all Vedas, the goal of all Vedic sacrifices or Vedic study or Vedic austerities recommended in the Vedas, methods of charity recommended in the Vedas, ultimately is to know Krishna. Because Krishna is the absolute truth. So the same goal is mentioned in the Vedanta Sutra, is mentioned in the Bhagavatam, is mentioned in the Bhagavad Gita. In all the confidential literature, the goal is described as the absolute truth or Krishna. But those who are not following the process of bhakti, for them to realize this ultimate goal as the supreme absolute truth Krishna takes a long time. As I was telling, one comes from the platform of karma to jnana. Jnana platform, what happens? One realizes that I am not this body, I am spirit soul. The nature of the absolute truth is also something spiritual, and I belong to that nature, spiritual nature. I don't belong to this material nature. So therefore, one tries to become free from this material entanglement, from material existence itself. One strives to get out of material existence. So one becomes very much desirous of attaining liberation from material bondage. This is called in the Bhagavad Gita, Siddhi, perfection of the human form of life, the civilized form of life, human form of life. So Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita, now everything that is described in detail in terms of the Vedic injunctions, karma kanda, jnana kanda. Karma kanda leads to jnana kanda. Jnana kanda leads to upasana kanda. But jnana kanda is very difficult. It's not very easy to ascertain that I am not this body, I am something different from matter, different from this body, is very, very, very difficult. Because jnana kanda consists of the Vedanta portion of the Vedas, the conclusion of the Vedas, describing the reality or the truth as something non-material. And to realize or understand, I am that something non-material, I am spirit, is very, very difficult. So there are so many Upanishads corresponding to different Vedas, that hundreds and hundreds of them are describing this nature of the soul, the reality of the soul, different from the body, and helps a person who is called a jnani, one who is pursuing knowledge of the truth or the knowledge of the absolute truth, ultimate reality. It actually leads to distinguishing spirit from matter and completely give up all kinds of matter, material possessions, material attachments to material situations, give up material existence itself, and try to prepare for entering into spiritual life, spiritual existence. But there is no much detail in the Jnana Kanda about actual description of spiritual life or spiritual existence itself after liberation. Nothing much is mentioned. So therefore, Jnana Kanda leads to Upasana Kanda or Bhakti, devotional service to Krishna. When one comes to the platform of bhakti through the gradual process, a lot of time would have been spent. Because karma kanda is 99.999% of the Vedas. Why? Because people have so many millions of varieties of desires. So there are varieties of pious activities recommended to fulfill varieties of desires. There are varieties of living conditions and varieties of upper planets, beginning from the earth planet, according to one's desires for enjoying materially in different ways. There are different facilities, different kinds of planets, different kinds of living conditions, different kinds of opulences, material opulences. Now one has to qualify for each of those. It's not that merely somebody learns about it and then says, I'm going to get it. No, one has to actually perform the particular pious activity, the particular vrata, particular sacrifice, a particular charity one has to give to a qualified brahmana or a qualified recipient of that charity. So different kinds of varieties of planets, different kinds of facilities, different kinds of opulences. So one can easily get carried away while pursuing karmakanda section of the Veda, studying them or following them, the Vedic injunctions. One can get actually carried away, which Krishna warns in the Bhagavad Gita right at the beginning. Yamimam pushpitam vacham pravadanti avipashitaha. Those who are not so intelligent, they are carried away by all these Vedic injunctions which promise enjoyment in different kinds of heavenly planets, with different kinds of facilities, with a very long duration of life. So much so that the devatas are called Amara. Amara literally means one who never dies. Though in one sense we are all Amara, as spirit soul, we are deathless. We don't die. But as far as the body is concerned, the body is definitely going to perish. Whether one has the body of a demigod, body of a human being, body of Brahma, it is going to perish. It's just a question of time. So relatively different types of bodies, there is different lifespan. So when one hears that devatas are amara, deathless, then one becomes very much excited that they have such nice facilities, they have nice opulences, they have so much power, they are very pious, they are nicely situated. One becomes very much excited to become, occupy one of the positions of the devatas, to attain that post of a devata. So much of different sacrifices, different. So Indra, for example, as I started mentioning, he has performed 100 Ashwamedha Yajnas and many other qualifications he has acquired to occupy that post of the king of the heavenly planets. King of the heavenly planets. So Indra's post is certainly very difficult to attain. But then he has done so much of difficult sacrifices he has performed. He has undergone all the restrictions while one is performing a sacrifice. Supposing a sacrifice lasts 48 days. 48 days, the eating, the sleeping, the activities, everything is completely restrained. If they are performing a sacrifice in which they can only take some milk, that also twice a day or once a day, something like that. They can't eat anything else. Then every time, every day, they have to sleep only on a straw mat for only some number of hours. When they're going to sleep, when they're going to rise, and what they're going to do immediately after rising. So many rituals are involved. Take a bath, then come, sit down, do this particular ritual, offer this particular ingredient into the fire. And for that, the brahmana has to chant the right mantra. At every step, they have to gradually make progression towards completion of the sacrifice. And every step, it has to be ensured that there is no mistake at all. If there is a mistake, there's a particular prayaschitta. To correct that mistake, they have to do something more. They have to do some fasting. They have to suspend the sacrifice. They cannot just go on like that. Just like in a production line, if they have to get a perfect product, right? If in between some defect is there, they have to reject the defective part and deal with it separately. Or if some major assembly, there is a problem, that has to be corrected. It cannot just go on like that. So similarly, to achieve the goal of successful completion of a sacrifice, any mistakes in between by anybody, That has to be corrected. Even the priest, if he is not chanting the mantra properly, there will be a referee priest. That referee priest will correct this priest by redoing the sacrifice by properly chanting the mantra. So many technical details are there in a Vedic sacrifice. Therefore, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu says that all these Vedic sacrifices are not practical to be performed in Kali Yuga, especially if somebody desires self-realization. If you want self-realization, then it is very, very, very difficult to perform these Vedic sacrifices and attain self-realization. And that is not practically possible for most of the people in Kali Yuga. Therefore, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu says that Harer Nama, Harer Nama, Harer Nama Iva Kevalam Kalo Nastyeva, Nastyeva, Nastyeva Gatiranyatha. In Kali Yuga, there is no other sacrifice other than the sacrifice of chanting the holy name. Now, the sacrifice of chanting the holy name is particularly mentioned by Krishna in the Bhagavad Gita. Yajnanam japa yajnosmi. Among all the types of yajnas, Krishna is represented particularly by the japa yajna. Japa yajna involves the sacrifice of chanting the holy name of Krishna, the Supreme Lord. Yajnanam japa yajnosmi. And even in the Kali Santarana Upanishad, again the Upanishads, you see, they are talking about the understanding or realizing that we are spirit and that the absolute truth is also completely spiritual by nature. And we have to actually get out of this material existence or material entanglement and attain our spiritual nature in relationship with the Supreme. There's a whole process of yoga, what's called as yoga. Yoga means, Prabhupada in one verse, by just giving one meaning to this word, Imam vivasvate yogam proktavanaham avyayam. Krishna summarizes the whole process of self-realization through yoga by just this one verse. He says, this science of yoga I taught to the sun god millions of years back. So Srila Prabhupada says in the word for meaning, Imam vivasvate yogam. Yogam means the science of one's relationship with the Supreme. You see? So in the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna has summarized everything that is required to be known by somebody who is desirous of the highest perfection in this human form of life that is to be attained. What is the process, the most efficient process? What are the different steps to be followed? What is the real goal? How to achieve that goal? How quickly one can achieve that goal? End of this life, if somebody is desirous of getting the highest goal, reaching the highest goal. That Krishna describes in the Bhagavad Gita. Tyaktva deham punarjanmanaiti mameti. In the Bhagavad Gita, he describes this. So therefore, the entire Mahabharata, even though it is presenting dharma with all the intricacies of family life, of political life, of different kinds of duties to be performed by different kinds of people in different situations, Brahmana dharma, Kshatriya dharma, Vaishya dharma, Shudra dharma, Brahmachari dharma, Grahastha dharma, Vanaprastha dharma, Sanyas dharma, Stri dharma, Raja dharma, Apad dharma, every kind of dharma is described in the Mahabharata with solid examples in the lives of great personalities who followed that, who practiced that. It is described, it is history, it is itihasa. With historical references, the dharma is described. So what is the conclusion of all this description of dharma in the Mahabharata, with all the details? It's a very interesting story. It's a wonderful presentation for people who are not inclined to study the Vedas, which are very, very technical and difficult to understand. Simply some set of injunctions. And the result of those, following those injunctions, are given in the original Vedas. So in Kali Yuga, people are not having time. Neither they are inclined to study the Vedas like that. So the Itihasa is presented specially for people in Kali Yuga. But Kali Yuga is such that even this Itihasa called Mahabharata, which is especially presented for people in Kali Yuga, people are not inclined to study the whole of Mahabharata. Or they may miss out the real essence of Mahabharata, the conclusion of Mahabharata. Therefore, Vyasadeva especially has put that Bhagavad Gita in the Mahabharata. The essence of the teachings of Mahabharata is simply summarized in the Bhagavad Gita. And even in the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna, while instructing Arjuna in that situation where Arjuna was confused about his duty, in all the scriptures, this is the important point. What is the duty of a human being? Even though the Vedas say so many duties, everybody's duties are described in the Vedas. Karma brahmodbhavam viddhi brahmakshara samudbhavam. In the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says, everyone should perform prescribed duties. That is what Krishna says is performance of sacrifice. In the third chapter of the Bhagavad Gita, Krishna says, you can become free from all reactions and become liberated simply by performing your work as sacrifice. To perform work as sacrifice, what should one do? One should simply follow the particular duties mentioned in the Vedas for your particular position. So the Vedas say the human society, civilized human society, should be divided into four varnas and four ashramas. And all civilized people fit into one of these four varna divisions and one of the four ashrama divisions. And then according to that, the scriptures prescribe certain duties. And those duties, if one performs as sacrifice to Vishnu, then one can simply, by performing one's duties as sacrifice to Vishnu, achieve the highest perfection of ultimate liberation from material bondage. That's possible. But where are people inclined to follow the injunctions of the scriptures in terms of varnashrama? In Kali Yuga, varnashrama is very difficult to follow, very impractical. In a former age, it was possible. In Kali Yuga, it is very difficult. Therefore, varnashrama system is not actually very practical to follow. Therefore, the scriptures say one should take to this direct process, not the gradual process. So that is explained in the Bhagavad Gita. And even in the Mahabharata, when Bhishma is instructing Yudhishthira, Yudhishthira asks one question after hearing about all the details of dharma from Bhishma. Yudhishthira asks a question, which dharma do you consider to be the topmost dharma? Ko dharma? Sarvadharmanam bhavata paramo matah. And Bhishma's reply is the Vishnu Sahasranama. Simply chanting the holy names of the Supreme Lord Vishnu is the topmost dharma. Which is the same thing what Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita. Yajnanam japa yajnosmi. Of all the yajnas, the best yajna, the topmost yajna, is actually the chanting of the holy name of the Supreme Lord. So the same thing is given in all the scriptures. But we have to understand this from the right source. Otherwise, one can get lost in the Mahabharata story, or one may come to a wrong conclusion by hearing from an unauthorized person. Some other conclusion. They come to so many wrong conclusions by studying the Mahabharata. They don't come to the right conclusion. So the conclusion of the Mahabharata is given in the Bhagavad Gita, in the form of Bhagavad Gita. In the Bhagavad Gita also, Krishna says, Sarva dharman parityajya mam ekam sharanam vraja. Now, what does this sarva dharman parityajya mean? Somebody who was reading the Bhagavad Gita, when I just joined this Krishna conscious movement 30 years back, so this one gentleman used to come to the temple. He was reading the Bhagavad Gita written by Prabhupada. So he came across this verse, sarva dharman parityajya, and he said, something is wrong there. Because Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita, dharma samsthapanarthaya sambhavami yuge yuge. I appear in every yuga, I incarnate, for the sake of establishing dharma. So why will Krishna say in the end of the Bhagavad Gita, 18th chapter, sarva dharman parityajya, why will he say give up all dharma, all types of dharma? So he was thinking, actually there's this printing mistake. He said it should be sarva adharman parityajya. I said no, it is sarva dharman parityajya only. So what is this sarva dharman parityajya? When Krishna has come to establish dharma, Krishna tells that you should perform your duty according to Vedic injunctions in third chapter. But what if there is difficulty in performing one's duties in the way it is recommended to be performed as sacrifice to Vishnu? If there is difficulty in performing one's duties and through that performance of duty offer sacrifice to Vishnu, then Krishna says you can give up all such activities which are prescribed in order to surrender to Krishna directly without having to bother about performance of one's duties. If there is any obstacle for surrender to Krishna because I have got so many duties to perform by which I am not able to surrender to Krishna, Krishna says, you can directly surrender to me without worrying about non-performance of your prescribed duties. And what if there is some reaction because I didn't do my duties? For that, Krishna says, aham tvam sarva pape bhyo mokshayishyami ma shuchaha. Do not worry. If in such surrender to me directly, you are not able to do some duties, and because of that there is some reaction, I will free you from all those reactions. You don't worry about those reactions. You don't worry about those. But Krishna is not giving a blanket permission for everybody. Don't bother about any duties. Or don't worry about any sinful reactions while you are doing some activities. No, that's not what Krishna is telling. There is no blanket permission for people to do sinful activities and simply make a show of surrender to Krishna and say, Krishna will take care of all my sinful reactions. No. Bhakti doesn't mean one can go on sinning and in the name of bhakti expect that Krishna will actually purify me of all sinful reactions. No. That's why while chanting Hare Krishna, there is a warning given that one who is chanting Hare Krishna does become free from all past sinful reactions. But one should not commit sinful activities on the strength of chanting Hare Krishna. What does it mean? That anyway I am chanting every day, even if I do some sinful activities, by chanting the sinful reactions will be nullified. So I don't have to worry about any sin that I may commit. No, that is not allowed. By chanting Hare Krishna, it is not that mechanically whatever sinful reactions I may have will be wiped out. No. It is only as a special consideration to encourage somebody who is surrendered, who is very desirous, very eager to make quick advancement to the platform of Krishna consciousness or devotional service, that Krishna encourages by telling that if you are engaged in devotional service exclusively, then don't worry about any past sinful reactions. I will take care of them, of nullifying them. But now onwards, no more sinful activities. Not that because I'm chanting, anyway, sinful reactions will be nullified by chanting. So I can go on committing sin. No. That's why when Srila Prabhupada gives diksha to anybody serious about making advancement on the path of bhakti yoga, one has to approach a bona fide spiritual master and take shelter and take initiation. So this initiation involves taking vows. So Srila Prabhupada says you have to take two vows. One is to chant Hare Krishna every day, 16 rounds minimum, to keep ourselves pure, to keep ourselves on the spiritual platform, in touch with Krishna through His holy name. We have to chant minimum of 16 rounds of Hare Krishna every day. And also we have to take a vow to abstain from all sinful activities, especially four kinds of pillars of sinful life in Kali Yuga: meat eating, intoxication, illicit sex and gambling. We have to abstain from all sinful activities, especially these four. Means we should be particularly careful not to violate these four principles: no meat eating, no intoxication, no gambling, no illicit sex. Because Kali Purusha has taken shelter of these four places. Places where there is animal killing, places where there is gambling, places where there is illicit sex, places where there is intoxication going on. So because Kali Purusha has taken shelter of these four places, these four sinful activities, particularly in Kali Yuga, are to be avoided by everyone. So therefore, the vows we take when we take Diksha is to avoid sinful activities, particularly these four, so that we don't become affected by the powerful influence of this age called Kali. Kali nashtadrishamesha puranar ko adhunoditaha. The Bhagavatam says that Kali, influence of Kali Yuga is such that people lose sight of the final goal of life. Even while they are pursuing some pious activities, they lose sight of the ultimate goal. So for such people, to help them understand what is the real goal of life, the Srimad-Bhagavatam has arisen like the sun to dispel the darkness, dense darkness of ignorance in this age of Kali. So Bhagavatam clearly says the goal of life is Krishna. Vasudeva paraveda, Vasudeva paramakha, Vasudeva param jnana, Vasudeva parantapa. Like that, in this beginning itself of the Bhagavatam, it is stressed. Krishna is the ultimate goal of all sacrifices, all penances, all austerities, all study. Everything, Krishna is the goal. And in Bhagavatam, Bhagavad Gita, just one line Krishna says, Vedaischa sarvai ahameva vedya. From all the Vedas I am to be done, means all Vedic processes, all Vedic sacrifices, all Vedic procedures, all Vedic injunctions aim at ultimately attaining Krishna, realizing Krishna. So that has been simplified by Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. You simply chant Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Thereby perform this Japa Yajna or Sankirtan Yajna. There are two ways of performing this Yajna of chanting the holy name. One is this Japa, where we chant and we hear and we count and we do a fixed number of times. Or we participate in Sankirtana, where congregationally one person sings in a melodious way this Hare Krishna mantra and others follow. So with instruments, a nice kirtan is performed and you join this kirtan. This is also yajna in this Kali Yuga, Sankirtan Yajna. So Sankirtan Yajna, Japa Yajna, the yajna of chanting the holy name is the recommended sacrifice. And we also should abstain from sinful activities, particularly four kinds of sins: no meat eating, no intoxication, no gambling, no illicit sex. So by this, very easily everyone can achieve perfection at the end of this life. In this very life, you can attain perfection. So this is what is taught by Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. This is the conclusion of the Bhagavad Gita, of the Bhagavatam, of the Vedanta Sutra, of all the scriptures. I'll stop here. Gantaraj Srimad Bhagavatam ki jai, Srila Prabhupada ki jai.
Hare Krishna. Subscribe to our channel and press the bell icon to never miss any updates.